Hello, everyone. Welcome to day 10 of the holiday card series for 2023. Just a quick housekeeping update. Last week, we announced a new class at onlinecardclasses.com. The class is called Relax and Rewind Holiday 2023, and it is open for registration. It is a live event on Sunday, December 3rd. So the links are down below in order to register for class. And there was early bird pricing for a full week, and that pricing, special pricing, ends tonight. So if you want to join us for this class, you'll want to make sure you take advantage of that pricing. And if not, not a huge deal. You can still sign up all the way up until, even after the event is live, you could still join us. So the links are down below for our holiday class. And I'm teaching that class or that event with my friends Jennifer McGuire, Kathy Zilski, and Dana Joy. Dana, who might be in the chat, sometimes she's in here with us during my lives. She's a moderator for my live chat. So big hello to Dana if she's joining us tonight. I'm not sure if she is or not. For day 10 of the holiday card series, I'm going to be using this adorable stamp set from My Favorite Things. It's called Christmas Selfies or Xmas Selfies. So cute. You can tell I've already stamped some and you'll see it in a minute. But seriously, like a cat building a snowman, snow reindeer, really. The cat with the reindeer under the mistletoe, a little reindeer with a tree. They are just so cute. And by the way, links to the stamp set are down below in the video description as well. If by chance you popped in or a little bit early, you were just waiting for the live stream to start, the links might not be there. So you could actually just hit refresh on your window or exit out of this live and come back in and the link will be there. Okay, so I had an idea for how to use these cute little selfie images. So this is my card sketch. Can you guys see that? There we go. So it's going to be a card that has like a fold out with three of those images on it. I'm going to have a 3D embossed background and I'm going to color with Copics. So I was trying to figure out exactly like the size of this centerpiece and I figured it out up here. So I've cut my cardstock to 8 1/4 wide and 3.5 tall. And then each section is 2 3/4 or 2.75 inches. So I knew there was some precision I need to have to get these just right. So I've actually already stamped it. I've already created it. So it's going to be a little element that goes on the front of the card. It's going to be closed like that. And then it folds out so you can see all three images. So isn't that just super cute? I just love it so much. So since I had these images in my Misty, hello. Well, okay. Good thing I have multiple bone folders. Here's my other bone folder. Since I had all of these images in my Misty and I was stamping them anyway, I stamped a second one so I could show you the scoring because the way you want to score is a little bit different. Well, it's really not that big of a deal. You probably could just score it how you might imagine. But because it's folded like this, like a Z fold, it will fold a little bit better if you do the scoring on the correct side. That'll make sense here in a minute. So when you're scoring cardstock, you always want to fold it with the bump on the inside. So if I want it like this, right? That means that right here, I need to score from this side. No, wait, hold on, I'm doing this wrong. I'm scoring right here, which is fine. So I'm going to use, this is the, the score and place tool from Simon Says Stamp. You could also just use a bone folder, but I thought this would just be a nice thing to use for precision. So I'm coming over to 2 3/4 and I'm going to score that right here. And then when I score this other one, I'm actually going to turn it this way and then flip it over and go to 2 3/4 as well. All right, so that makes it so I can fold this way and then this way. And I'll just have a little bit of a better fold. It's not that big of a deal which way you do it. Like this one, I scored both the same direction and then I just folded it whatever way you want. But you want to, whatever way you do it, you want to like kind of mess with it, kind of fold it back and forth, really get those folds working well so that it will lay flat on the card. All right, so here's my little tri-fold, and I'm gonna go ahead and score this or press it down with my bone folder really, really well on both sides to get it to try to lay as flat as possible. Of course, I am gonna have it fanned out for the coloring though. Okay, so here are my little images that I'm going to color. I'm using my Copic markers today, and I'm actually going to put a little bit of grid paper down below my work surface here since I'm coloring onto glass. Sometimes if you have some intense color with Copics, it bleeds through the paper. And if you're working on glass, sometimes that, if it's a lot of ink, it will pull up on top of the glass and then go back up through your cardstock from beneath. So sometimes it's good to just have some paper underneath where you're going to be coloring. All right, let's start with the cats because I already know kind of what colors those are going to be. You know they're going to be gray. Gray tabbies, right? Because that's how we roll around here. And I'm also going to color these very simply since I've got quite a bit of coloring to do today. All right, I'm starting with N2. In fact, you know, I probably could zoom in even a little bit more. Okay. So the grays I'm using are N2, N4, and N7. And I'm just gonna start with this cute little guy right here. Or I guess probably a girl, because they're going to be Sophie and Daphne, right? You know what, I'm gonna grab an N0 as well because I want her face to be pretty pale in comparison. All right, in fact, I'll just go over it completely. I'll do her full body actually. Why not? And I want her ears to be pink on the interior, so I'll just do a little bit of gray around the outside. And then I'm going to come and color this one the same way. Since it's the same animal, I'm just gonna color them at the same time. And it looks like my N0 needs to be refilled. I'm to the point where a lot of my markers need refilling. All right, I'm gonna go back to N2 and I'm gonna add that shading, like what I was starting to do, but then I decided it was too dark. So I'm just adding really simple shading. Maybe at the base of her ears too. All right, I'm just gonna get a little bit around her little paws, right there. I'm going to take my R20 and I'm just going to do cute little blush, a little pop of blush right there. So cute. All right, I'm going to take that N2 and I'm actually going to bring it all the way up now that I have seen what it looks like. And I was trying to keep this very simple coloring, but I'm finding myself wanting to add shading. So here we are. I'm going back to my N0 and I'm just adding a little bit of a feathering to get that to sort of blend a little bit. All just so it kind of fades, so it doesn't look like such a stark, dark line. Okay. I'm going to take my N4 and I'm just going to add a little bit of this in the darkest areas. So like underneath the scarf, probably right at the feet. Just around the face, and then I'm going to take my N2 and just kind of work backwards. I'm taking the N2 to blend out that darker shade. And then I'm going to take that N0, oh, not the pink, hello, that would have been bad. The N0 to blend that out a little bit more. Okay, I'm gonna have to get more shading up on her face, on the head, just because it's really bugging me. Okay. Going back to N2. And then N0. Probably spending too much time coloring the cat, but you know, here we are. Add a little bit of that dark shade. Hello, that's the darkest shade. I didn't mean to do that one. N4 is my dark shade for the shadow. Add that right there. Fade that with N2. And back to N0. Basically forcing it to blend a little bit. All right, so I'm gonna come over here and add that N4 all around. And get those darkest areas. Back to N2. Just kind of blend that out. Oh, I forgot to add a little bit of the darker shade over here. All right. I apologize for not looking over in the chat very much. I don't want to neglect the chat, but I also want to keep the coloring moving, you know? Okay, I'm gonna go back to N0. Just kind of get that blended up into the face. And I'll go over that area as well. And then I'm going to take my pink and I'll get the little tongue. And I'm also going to do just a little bit of pink on the ears. Okay, then I'm taking my darkest shade, N7. I'm just gonna get those little marks on the cat, and there's not enough, so I'm adding a few more because we know my kitties have more stripes than that. So I'm going to add just a couple on the arms, and then I'll have just a couple on the back too. Oh, so cute. Just adding those little stripes. So cute. Love it so much. Hello, everyone over in the chat. Since I'm swapping colors now, now's a great time to say hello. It does look a little bit like Daniel Tiger, if Daniel Tiger was gray. All right. Let's focus on this one and just finish off that one first. So I'm going to have the snowman and also the little bank of snow. I'm going to have that be a pale blue shade. This is powder blue. I'm just going to test it over there. That is not the blue shade that I wanted it to be. Let's try a different one. Maybe like a B01. Yeah, that's a little better. Okay, so I'm just going to add, oh, that's really dark. That's better. I'm just adding a little bit of blue, just kind of like underneath the cat. And then I'm adding that blue as shadow on our little snow reindeer. Just like that. It's a little bit bright. So I'm gonna tip it up so you can see where the blue is on that. All right, let's do really simple little nose. And I think I'm going to have this cat have a red scarf, and then I'll have the reindeer have a green scarf. So here are two of my favorite shades for red. In fact, I'm going to start with the darkest color and bring that in. Reds can get really, really, what's the word? Juicy, really fast. Like you might end up adding a whole lot more than you really thought you were going to. So sometimes I like to start with the darkest shade first, just so I don't add too much red and have it like bleed out everywhere. All right. I'm going to keep this red combo out here on my desk. All right. And then for a green, let's see. I'm going to consult a couple of previously colored Christmas items. You guys might remember this girl from a few years ago. I really like the greens that are there. I've got quite a few little pre-colored, like if I was going to do someone blonde, those are the colors I'd use. But I just keep these around because they were like tests that I did. And I really like those colors. So the greens are G20, G24, and G28. Okay, where are these? I probably could just do G24 and G28. Keep it simple, just like I did with the red. So G24, G28. I'm going to do the same thing I did with the red and go in with the darkest shade first. All right, I'm going to come in with my green. It's a nice Christmas green. And I'll use that same green on this tree over here just to keep it really consistent. Okay, and then I kind of want this to almost look like a little bit of a night scene. So let's see. Prussian blue, that's a really nice blue. Let's do that one. Actually, before we do that, let's get the little antlers. Okay. All right. So now I'm going to come in here and start coloring with this blue. In fact, I might want to do two colors of blue, do the darkest one at the bottom, and then switch it to, let's see. Yeah, I'll do that. I'll switch it to B37 as it comes up. Trying to not cover the picture too much as I'm, you know, I want you to just like look at my hand the whole time, you know? So I'm trying to like bring my hand away from the tip of the marker so you can see what's going on. Doing some very careful coloring when it comes to the, you know, edges and around those snowflakes. Just because I want to make sure I have a really clean image. So you have a couple other options you could do if you wanted to make a card kind of like this. You could color the little square pictures, cut them out, and then glue them onto your final project. That's one way to do it so you don't have to worry about, you know, like coloring past the edges. But basically, I guess I'm a sucker for punishment because I'm like, let's just stamp it directly on it. Why not? But also, I was thinking ahead to like trying to minimize the layers of cardstock. In fact, when it comes to the finished card, it's not going to open up like a regular card. It's going to be just a flat panel. And then it'll have these, you know, the three panels that fold out with the pictures on it. So in that case, you know, you're going to have like four layers of cardstock as is. And I'm trying to keep it down so that it's not too heavy or too thick when it comes to mailing. That's one of those advantages of, you know, planning out your card in advance and really thinking through all the different kind of how it's going to be assembled, like all the different layers and how it's going to be put together so that you can anticipate any problems. Okay. I'm just going to clean up this edge right there. There we go. And I've just got to color in this last little section. And then we'll be done. In fact, that snowflake right there kind of got lost, so I'll probably have to use my white gel pen just to bring it back. But not a huge deal. Okay. In fact, let's just go ahead and fix that right now. There we go. Just bring that right back. In fact, you guys know I cannot help myself. I somehow always need to add like a little bit of texture on scarves. So I'm going to take my R59 and add just some little stripes. And this will give it just a little bit of a texture, just like that. And I'm going to do the same for that green. So G29. Do I want polka dots? No, I know what I'll do. I'll do a really thin. Like a little, I'm going to do it like a check. I guess I could kind of make it like a plaid. We'll make it like a plaid. Just like that. Oh, much better. We needed some texture on that one. Okay, now we're on to the reindeer and the Christmas tree. So this is going to be a whole lot of green. I'm going to use those same greens that I did before. And I'm just going to go ahead and do a whole wash of my lightest green, G24. I'm going to color over the entire thing, just avoiding, well, I guess it could be popcorn or it could be Christmas lights. I think I'm going to have mine be Christmas lights just so I can have a few more colors. Or I guess it could be ornaments too. But whatever it is, mine will be colorful. Speaking of Christmas trees, I'm in the process of putting our main Christmas tree up. And I wanted to share with you all a tip that I saw online. You might already be doing this, but when it comes to like fluffing your artificial Christmas tree. So, you know, when you put it up, if you're not already fluffing your Christmas tree, I really encourage you. You will seriously, it makes it look like a whole new tree. And it's basically when you go in and you like bend all the branches so they're straight again. And it just looks a little, you know, it fills it out and makes it just look so much prettier. So a couple tips for when it comes to fluffing. Wear long sleeves and put on some gloves. Even just like little cheapy little $1 gloves from, you know, like Walmart or Target or whatever. That will protect your hands and forearms from getting scratched up while you're reaching into the tree. And then also, when it comes to fluffing of the tree, I just tried this year and I texted my friend Christine. She's like, I've been doing that for years. I feel like I'm ahead of the game. I'm like, well, I just heard about this tip online just recently. But basically, when you're putting up your artificial Christmas tree, you've got your tree stand, put the first tier on, fluff that, because then you can like really see the interior and see what you're getting at. Then put the next tier on and fluff that. So, and then put the next one on and then so on. I used to always put the whole thing together and then fluff it. And then I could never remember where it was at. And I couldn't see like the interior of the tree. So, anyway, I did it that way this year where, you know, I did it in sections as I was assembling the tree. I couldn't believe how much better it went. I feel like it was faster and I feel like it filled out the tree more. I was just loving it. All right, so I'm going to do like right underneath these lights or beads or popcorn, whatever they are, just right up underneath. I'm also going to do underneath this section. And then I'll blend that out with that other color. That's just going to start filling in the tree. Also, since, you know, I'm coloring and I've got, you know, lots of time to fill with chit chat. I'm feeling so much better. I think my allergies are finally calming down. I'm feeling much better overall. I'm sure all of you were wondering. I'm kidding. I'm being very sarcastic here. But just, you know, optimistic. Of course, I start feeling better after I get that appointment with an allergist. That's not happening until February. That makes me laugh. But you know what, though? Even though it would have been nice to go see an allergist and start to get some relief from it, like while it was actively really bad, I'm so glad that it is calming down. This is a big section of this image here. So I'm just taking my time. I think it definitely helps it look a little bit better, especially being such a large area if you've got a little bit of shading on it, you know? Okay, I'm gonna just bring in a little bit of that shading. Okay. And then we'll figure out what the little banner, those colors are gonna be here in a minute. Let's color the reindeer. So let's see here. This is what I like to do when I'm coloring little cartoon images like this. I'm gonna go to Google and look up reindeer clip art or reindeer illustration or whatever. And I just wanna see how other people have colored reindeer. So I can just see some examples. All right, so here we are, reindeer clip art. I knew it was like two tones of brown, but I was like, how are they doing this? Okay, so basically his chest is supposed to be light and the rest is dark, but okay, that's interesting. Okay, I'm gonna have to like color his face differently. Okay. I'm gonna pick two colors. Get out my little Copic swatch chart so I can pick out some colors. I'm thinking E31 and E35 look great. E31 and E35, and I already have 37 out, perfect. I'm gonna need 33 though. Okay. So 31 and 33. So I'm going to have his face be the lightest brown shade, avoiding his nose so I can make it red like Rudolph. And I'm also going to have his tummy be the same color. All right, I'm gonna take the darker, the E33, and just add that around the sides and where there would be shadow. And then go back to that lightest shade and just kind of blend up from that. Okay, I'm gonna take that color that I used for blush on the cats. In fact, it's lost some of it, so I'm gonna add that back in because I added it and then did all the blending. I'm gonna add that blush in on his little cheeks, just like that. All right, I'm going to do the lighter shades on the interior of his ears as well. Okay, and then for the darker browns, I'm using E35 and E37. I'm using Nina Solar White 80 pound for my coloring today. So I'm gonna take my E35 and I'm just doing a nice wash of color. Over the entire area. And then I'll come in and add my shading. Get those ears. Okay. Then for the shading, I'm using E37 and I'm just adding where it would be the darkest. I'm just adding it all the way around and at the base of the ears. And I'll take that little bit lighter shade and kind of blend that in. I can also do a wash over that entire area again. Then I'm going to come back to that darker shade and I'm going to add some shadow right underneath his chin and his arms and then the bottom of his feet. I'll just blend that out just a little bit. I feel like I lost some of the shading right there and on the side, so I'm just going to add that back in. And I'm also going to add just a little more shading with the darker of the lighter colors because I just want to get that shadow line right there. There we go. And I think I'm going to use the lighter shade for his antlers too. There we go. All right, for his nose, I'm going to use those two colors of red that I used on the cat's scarf. I'm going to go with the darkest shade first and just put that right at the bottom. And then do the lighter red right on his nose. Oh, he's so dang cute. Okay, so I think I'm going to do red, blue, and pink, I think, for the little lights or beads or whatever we want to call it. So I'm going to, is this kind of the blue I want? Yeah, that's about the blue I want, actually. Let's just do a lighter version of this. So it would be B34, just because I want it to get in the same kind of color tones as the other blue. Okay. So we'll do R35 for the red, B34 for the blue, and for the pink, you know, I should have colored this reindeer at the same time. Hello, Christina. Whatever. Let's see, is this the kind of pink that I want? Yeah, okay. So I'm just gonna do skip two, and then I'll do pink right here, skip two, pink, skip two. Okay, so they're gonna be like in a pattern. So right after the pink is when I do the red. Then I can do the same colors on our little banner. Okay, so let's do blue. Pink. And red. Then we just need to color the floor and the wall. I'm assuming it's inside. Okay. Let's have the wall be, I'm thinking maybe just like a, I don't even know. You guys in the chat, let me know what you want the wall and the floor to, what colors the wall and the floor to be. I'm going to go ahead and color this other reindeer. The one that's sticking its tongue out at us. Okay, using that lighter shade for the reindeer's face. This is a sassy little reindeer. The cat's just like, hey, let's take a cute little selfie. And then the reindeer's like, and stuck its tongue out. See, you're on the nice-ish list. It's talking about the reindeer. Okay. Hi, Sika. All right, I'll come back to the lighter shade, kind of blend that out a little bit. In fact, since these antlers are a little bigger, I'm gonna add a little shading on those as well. Come in with that pink shade for the blush. Oh, I like the idea of grays for the, because it kind of brings in the gray into that one. I kind of like the idea of the gray. All right. Make sure I get the caps on the right ones. I'm going back to my two tones of the darker brown. So this is the lighter of the two shades, the E35. Okay, and then I'm gonna add the shadow. And then bring in that lighter brown just to sort of blend that out. Okay. I'm going to take the lightest color, and I see how it's like bleeding in right there. I'm just going to kind of color over it, over that area, and that'll kind of push it back. Okay. All right, I need to blend out that shading on the tummy. I forgot to. So the lightest shade, let's blend that out. All right. I'm also going to take the pink for his little tongue. And then the two colors of red for his nose, just like the other one. All right, so I'm going to use the darkest red at the bottom and the lighter red right there. And while I've got the reds out, I'm going to go ahead and do these berries. I guess technically, I think mistletoe is actually white. It has a white berry. Is that true? And so when you see mistletoe that has red berries, it's actually just, you know, holly. Holly and berries. Okay. We're moving right along. Okay. I like the idea of gray. I saw a lot of people saying like grays or like more neutrally colors for the floor and the wall. I think I like the idea of bringing in the gray in. So there's like a cohesive use of color. So I think I'm going to use the N2 and N4 for the floor and the wall. I'm going to use N2 on the wall. Yeah, this will look nice. It'll just bring it into focus. In fact, I'm going to use that N0 at the very top, similar to like I did with the nighttime sky over on the other side. I'm just going to bring in like a lighter shade up at the top. Come back to that lightest shade and kind of blend that edge. Kind of get those colors to blend a little bit more. And then I can just use the lightest shade over here. Okay. So now I've got, I'm going to do N4 and N6. Just because I do want a little bit of a darker color for right underneath the reindeer and under the tree. So this is the N4. And I'm just going to very carefully go around that area. And then I'm going to add the darker, just really sparingly, just right up against the tree and the reindeer. Then I can use the slightly lighter gray to blend it out. And I'm going out of the lines a little bit here. I'll fix that with a white gel pen. Okay. Then I'm going to have to bring in some other colors over here, like for that wall and floor. All right, using my white gel pen just to fix that area right there, where I got a little messy coming out of those areas. Mistletoe was the state flower of Oklahoma until 2004? Wow. Yeah, someone's talking about ad rolls on lives. Yeah, it's weird. I do have some control over it, but I also don't. Like with my software that I use for streaming, I don't know how to add one in. I've got to like experiment. Okay, so I'm going to take my two greens and I'm just going to add the shading on these leaves. And then come in with the lighter green. And just finish those off. Okay. So now we just have to do the background on that one. I'm trying to decide how I can kind of incorporate this. I'm thinking maybe I should do the same blues as over here. And I don't know. Or maybe I'll have it be the blue ground and then like a lighter blue background. I like that idea. Okay, so I'm going to use those same two blues. The lighter blue. I'm going to be really careful around the bottom edge of that square this time. Okay. Then I'm just going to add a little bit of the, oh man, I went out of the line again. I'm going to add just that darkest blue down here at the bottom. And then come back with the lighter blue and kind of get it to fade up. Okay. I like bringing that blue in just because I can't stand it. A little bit of white gel pen. All right. And then I'm going to do just a lighter blue up at the top. And like even lighter than that blue. So that was B34. I'm going to try B32. Yeah, that works. Oh, I want even paler than that. B32. Is there like a B30? Are you serious? There isn't one? Wow. Okay. So maybe like a B41. No. Well, I guess I could bring in like a, that'll have to work. Okay. All right. So I'm bringing in this blue. Kind of right around here. And then like, do we really want to use this other blue? I guess I am. It's just a little bit of a brighter blue. It's interesting. Lighter, but brighter. I think it'll kind of harken back to the first image with the snowman. Yeah, I think it works. I think having like a pale blue wall looks really, really pretty. I'm just loving navy everything right now. A couple years ago, we got this really nice, big, oversized velvet chair for our bedroom, and it's dark, a dark navy, and it's just luscious. Of course, do we sit in the chair? No, it's the cat's chair. So it's covered in fur. I have a blanket over it now, so it's not completely covered in fur. It's a little easier to clean off, but. All right, I'm gonna bring in this other blue and just kind of get that fading up a little bit more. Okay, I love that. That's so cute. Okay. I almost wish I wouldn't have done that white gel pen down here because now I kind of want to put a little bit of a shadow line. Do I dare? I do. I'm going to use N2. And just do like a little shadow line. The white gel pen shows. That's okay. Whatever. And just do a little shadow line. There we go. All right, I have 5 million markers that I've used, but this card is gonna be finished here in just a minute or so because you just have to kind of put it on a card. A Am I forgetting to color anything? I don't think I am. I think we're good. Okay. So let's back that out. Ugh, even cuter once you see it like all together. All right. So my little trifle is going to go like this. I didn't even think about the fact that you could see that on the back, but really when you fold it out, who's really going to be looking at that side? I mean, I guess I could put more white cardstock on the back, but like I said, I'm trying to avoid adding more bulk to the card. All right, I'm going to really crease that down. Okay, and then for the card base, I have some red cardstock. This is from Spellbinders. This is the color Phone Booth. And I've cut it to an A2 size. And so it's going to go on this just like that. But I thought it'd be fun to add some texture to it. So I thought I'd use an embossing folder. So I've got my Spellbinders Platinum 6 here. And the embossing folder I'm going to use today is Holly and Foliage from Spellbinders. So what I like to do when I'm doing these 3D embossing folders is I'm going to spray my cardstock both sides, just spritz it, just mist it a little bit. I've also heard Jennifer McGuire, she said that she just uses a wet baby wipe to get it damp. Totally valid. All right, so I'll place that in there, build my little sandwich, and then get it started and run it through. All right. Move our little die cutting machine. And then here we have our embossed background. Ooh, that's pretty. I like that. I also wouldn't mind doing like a pale blue since we've got that pale blue on the coloring. I'm going to hit this with my heat tool just to speed along the drying. Okay, so then this is going to go just right on there. But like I said, because I'm trying to reduce the bulk of like a very thin cardstock on the back, on the very back, so to write a message. Hopefully that makes sense. So I've got just some 80-pound cardstock. So this is 100-pound. I'm going to use 80-pound, and hopefully that'll reduce it a little bit. I mean, I guess I could also just use like, what's the word? Like regular thin, like computer paper. All right. I'm going to use my paper trimmer here just to cut this down. This is the new Tim Holtz trimmer and it's lovely. Let me tell you. Okay. I'm going to cut it down to like, let's see. I'm going to take 3/4 off each side. So you can still see the texture on the background of the red cardstock. Okay. I'll just get rid of my trimmer. So I'm going to be adhering this right to the back of the embossed panel so that I have somewhere to write a message. So I'm just going to take my Tombow Extreme adhesive, getting fuzz all over it. That's okay. It's the back, right? Add some adhesive and then put that directly in the center. Press that down. And then on this side, I'm going to be adhering our little trifold. So I only need adhesive on the very back. Adding quite a bit of adhesive so that all the areas that are sticking up get a little bit there. Okay, and I'm just gonna adhere that. Press that down. And now we have our cute little card. Oh, stop it. I love that it's got like a little extra something to it. All right, and it's still, you know what? It is very flat. It's not real heavy, even with all those additional layers of cardstock. I love that so much. It is so dang cute. Stop it. Okay, so I'm gonna give a little spiel for those watching the edited replay, which the edited replays now go up the morning after the lives. So here we are. I'm gonna do a little spiel for the edited replay, and then I'll stick around for just a few minutes to answer questions. I'm seeing questions in the comments about the new trimmer and all that. So we'll talk about that in a minute here. All right, so here is the final card for day 10 of the holiday card series. It still remains very thin, very lightweight. I think it's gonna do great going through the mail, but we have that additional surprise when you open up the little trifold. Love that. There's also a place on the back to write a message. Love that so much. So just a reminder that you can register for the latest class at onlinecardclasses.com, which is a live event taking place on December 3rd. We'd love to have you. You can register for that all the way up until the day of or even afterwards so you can catch it on replay. The live event, it's kind of all day long. It runs from 9:30 a.m. Eastern until about 5 p.m. Eastern, and there are breaks in between sessions. So you can like take a break and whatever. And if you miss any of those sessions, you can watch it later on replay. So links to Relax and Rewind Holiday 2023 are down below. There is early bird pricing through Monday night. You're probably seeing this edited replay on Tuesday morning, so you won't have early bird pricing anymore, but it's still very reasonably priced. And it's a great class for beginners and experienced card makers alike. All right, thanks so much for watching today, and I will be back on Wednesday with day 11. Can't believe we're already day 11. Thanks for watching, and I'll catch you guys next time. All right. Christine says, you've got to put some money in that as well. That's what the sentiment implies. Here's some jingle for you. That's true. That is very true. Like, put like dollar bill in the envelope. That would be really funny. All right. So many classes. Yay. Rick is asking, what's the class about? So the class is actually, it's a technique class, and it's very relaxed and laid back. Being a holiday class, we know that no one wants anything really stressful or added stress around the holidays. So basically we are teaching 12 different techniques. You're not even finishing them off on a card, but you're going to do like 12 background techniques and then die cut the background into a shape of your choice. It could be a circle, almost like an ornament. It could be a tree. It could be a star. It could be all sorts of things. And then at the end of the class, you'll have all these little die cuts that you can put on cards, or you can put on a canvas for some holiday wall art, or you can just, you know, keep them as tags in your stash. Basically, they're to remind you of all those 12 techniques that you can use on your cards well past the holiday season. And it's going to be a really fun class. Minimal homework needed. You can use whatever supplies you have on hand. If you have been crafting for a little bit of a while, that was a weird phrase. If you've been crafting for a while, you probably have all the supplies you'll need for all 12 techniques. A lot of the techniques just use inks and water and embossing powder and a heat tool. There's going to be a basic supply list that will be provided to you a week in advance. So basically you'll get that supply list this coming up Sunday, and then you'll have a week to pull your supplies together and then join us for the live class. TJ is asking, how much is the class? It is $27, but right now it's on sale for $24, I believe. So come and join us. It's one of those great classes that's kind of like use whatever you have on hand, which is great for the holidays. So you don't have to purchase anything. I mean, of course, if you want to purchase things, we'll have links, but you don't have to, which is great. Okay. Let's see. Misty's saying, be sure to click on the schedule. There is a homework event the week before. Yes. So basically 2 weeks from yesterday being Sunday, 2 weeks from that day is the event. 1 week from that day, so this coming up Sunday, the Sunday after Thanksgiving, we're having a live event for students only, and it will be going over the homework and what supplies you need and kind of answer questions so that you're a little bit more prepared for the day of. But even if you don't do any homework or you don't come to the homework event the week before, you should still be able to come and enjoy the event and kind of craft along with us. Most of the techniques that we're teaching, you could kind of watch the technique being taught and then grab your supplies and then craft along with us. I think there'll be enough time for that. So you don't have to do the homework. Yes, it is all online, TJ. Okay, so let's see. Let's go back and get some questions. TJ's, I'm in the UK. Yes, this is online, so everyone can join in worldwide. In fact, it's a great one for all of our international crafters because you don't need any specific supplies. So you can just use whatever you've got on hand. Okay. So we had some questions. One was about the trimmer. So let's talk about the new Tim Holtz trimmer, which I find I'm using more and more and more. Let me see if I can back out here a little bit so you can see the trimmer. You're seeing a little more of my crafting desk here, which is a nice big glass mat. All right. So this is the new trimmer from Tim Holtz and Tonic, which is great. It has pull out rulers on both ends. So if you like to put your paper up to the top of your trimmer, got you covered there. If you like to come to the bottom, that's great too. I find myself using the bottom on this trimmer, which is really, really convenient. It has like this little arm here is on a spring, so it's constantly up. You don't have to lift it up to put your project underneath. So if I was going to be cutting this, I can just slide it under and then I can press it down and that kind of locks it in place and the paper's not going to shift too much, which is kind of nice. It's a nice feature for this type of trimmer. There are, when you buy the trimmer itself, I believe it comes with two of these heads. One is a cut. Can you see that blade there? And the other is a score. And it's the handle is a light gray, which is really nice. So if you want, you can use this for scoring as well. I love that there's a ruler right in the middle also, just so you can like double check your measurements. So, you know, as you're bringing in your cardstock, you can look down here at the bottom. Well, actually I should do this as an example. You can look down here at the bottom, like, okay, I'm going to cut this at 2 1/4. You can come up here and get that aligned with 2 1/4 as well, just so you make sure you have that measurement. That's really, really nice. Okay, so this is the trimmer. I really, really love it. It's very lightweight. Like I can pick it up and move it around. It's low profile. I've just really loved it. I just like have it off to the side and I pull it in when I need it. The rotary cutter from Tim Holtz, which also came out earlier this year, is a little more heavy duty. You can use it to cut lots of different surfaces. This one is, I think, you know, when I talked to Tim about it a while back, he said it was, he was really thinking of paper crafters when he was coming up with this trimmer with Tonic. So this is, it's going to be great for scrapbookers who need that 12 inch dimension, the rulers on both ends. They've really thought it out well. I really love this trimmer. It's a great one. I would not hesitate to recommend it to anyone who needed a trimmer. Okay, let me see. I think Amanda, let's see, off topic question. Any tips or tricks for cruising? I'm taking my first cruise in December. I'm so excited for you. It's going to be amazing. I'm trying to think of my best cruising tips. First of all, off the bat, whatever cruise line you're on most likely has an online component where you can go in and plan certain aspects of your cruise. If you haven't explored that yet, go to your cruise line's website, log in. You can use your booking number or your confirmation number and go in and just familiarize yourself with that. You could also look up that particular ship's deck plan or floor plan and get an idea of where your room is and where some of the different venues are on the ship. Those are things that I like to do. What essentially most everything that you need that you would pack, if you forgot it, you could probably find it on the ship or at your first port. But there are a few things you cannot replace. Your passport, make sure you have your passport. Sometimes people, if they're cruising round trip from the United States, they won't require a passport. I recommend having one. So if you've got one, don't forget to pack it. And also keep your passport with you at all times. So if you're checking a bag on your plane, keep your passport in your personal item or your carry-on bag that you're taking on the plane itself. Just basically keep your passport with you at all times. Don't put it in a bag that will be apart from you for any period of time. I would say the same thing for any medications or anything that would be very hard to replace. So if you've got medications that, that you're going to be taking or whatever, make sure you've got those on your person when you go. I'm trying to think what else with cruising. Another tip, sometimes there's a lot of paper involved on the cruise, being that you're going to get like shopping ads and itineraries and different things just put in your room when you're on the cruise. And sometimes it can be overwhelming having all this paper being thrown at you. So what I do is I bring little magnets, and you can use a magnet to hold those papers up to the walls in your room, in your stateroom. All of the walls on cruise ships are metal. That's how they build it and put it all together. So you can use those magnets on the walls or on the bathroom door or things like that. So those are my main tips. There we go. Okay, let's see here. So many of you signed up for class. Love it. I'm so excited to have you there. Suki's asking the size of the trimmer. I think I covered that. Like, you can get like a full 12 inches top to bottom, even more than that, maybe. It's basically about 8 inches wide, maybe a little bit more, maybe like 8 by 12. And the profile is really short, like maybe like half an inch. Okay. Rebecca's asking, what is the size of the front again? Are you asking about the front of the card? It's just a regular A2? Or are you talking about this little deal? I'll show you this again. I'll show you my sketchbook where I did all the measurements. So the fold out piece is 8 1/4 by 3.5, and you're scoring at 2 3/4 from each edge. And that'll get you the correct little fold out for this. Basically, I just figured out how big I wanted one of these to be. And then I just added two more on and added up those measurements. Ta-da. Okay. Kay is saying, pre-book your excursions or you'll be disappointed when they're already full once you get on board. That is very true. Sometimes you if you haven't pre-booked, you won't be able to get into an excursion. But also, if you haven't bought any excursions, there are always some available. It just might not be your first choice. If you're going to do an excursion through the cruise line, I highly recommend it. You can do third-party excursions. However, if for whatever reason that excursion is late getting back to the ship, if you are with a third-party company for that excursion, the ship will not wait for you. They will possibly leave and leave you at that port. But if you're on a cruise line's excursion, they're keeping track of you, and the excursion company that the cruise line works with, they will be in contact with the ship and say, hey, we're stuck in traffic, we're going to be late, and the ship will wait for you. Also, if they, if something happens and you're on that cruise line excursion and you're going to be late, the cruise line, they keep track of who hasn't come back yet. And if you're not back and they're like, wait, are they on an excursion? And if you are on a cruise line excursion, they will wait for you. I mean, don't take advantage of that. Like, don't think like, hey, I'm going to go do some shopping after my excursion, because that won't work, because everyone else from your excursion is back. But anyway, I just think it's a little bit of a safety net, you doing a cruise line excursion. I have done some from third parties or gone out on my own without a problem. I would just give myself a couple of hours buffer to get back to the ship just in case something happens. So if you're going to do a third party excursion, let's say you have to be back on board at 4:30, I would not plan to be on that excursion past 2:30. That's going to give me plenty of time to get back. Okay. I know, ads during Alive is new, annoying and rude. Yes, I know. I'm so sorry. You can't even opt out of them. Like, it's dumb. It's really, really dumb. But you guys will have to let me know. If you have an ad, does it pick up where you left off? Like, does it pick up, or is it like you just missed everything that's happened during that ad? I don't even know. Let me know. Let's see here. Misty saying, make a copy or two of your passport in case you have to report to an embassy for passport replacement. Happened to me in Spain. Thankfully, my mom had a copy back home. That's great. I also, what I'll do is I'll just take a picture of my passport with my phone. And then, I'll delete that picture once I get home, just so it's not a problem. Or just keep it on there, you know. But a photocopy is a really good idea, too. Nancy says, I don't know why, but my cuts are always wonky with those types of trimmers. You know, I've had trouble with those too. This one is different. I think maybe because it has that spring-loaded arm that you can press down and it really holds your paper in place. I think maybe that's why I've had better luck with them. Let's see here. Kay says, been on 3 Alaska cruises, 1 round Hawaii, 1 once West Coast, the Mexican Riviera, and several Baja cruises. So much fun. Yes, this is like right up my alley. You guys are like, yes, awesome. Let's see here. Oh, Rebecca's headed for a cruise this Saturday. Right after Thanksgiving is such a good time to cruise. I'm so jealous. Oh, Amanda's cruising in Thailand and Vietnam. Oh, that's amazing. I love that. What size is your glass mat? I think it's the 18 by 24. And I picked black because I actually have a white version too. And I was going to use white, but I found that when I'm like videoing and stuff like that, that the black makes the colors pop a little bit more. I think it looks a little bit better. But if I was not videoing, I'd probably have a white mat, because then it really shows if there's like ink on the surface and it's a little bit cleaner. Any chance you're doing any upcoming cards with your Karen markers? That's a good idea. I haven't used my Karen markers in a while. Thank you. I might have to do that. Let's see here. Donna says, if we sign up for the class and cannot attend, will the class still be available to watch later? Yes, it will. In fact, we are holding the live sessions at YouTube, you know, at private links that only students will have access to. And so just like when I have a live here on YouTube, how it's saved and then you can rewatch it later and even see the live chat scrolling by, it will be exactly like that. So you should be able to see the class replays after the fact. Okay, let's see here. Let's see here. Oh no, my parents just lost money over third-party excursions and bad timing. Yeah, sometimes you're taking a risk with the third-party excursions. Let's see. Oh no, Amanda says you'll miss everything that happens during the ad. That really sucks. I'm so sorry, you guys. I'm gonna look into like if I can control where the ad is. And then when that happens, I'll just like take a break. Like in the, you know, what's happening. Gosh, I'm so sorry. Oh, Terry says, picks up where you left off. I don't know. I have no idea. Okay. Let's see here. Let's see. Any other questions? All right. Yes, the white mat can cause the camera to wash everything out when recording. The class prep, if you're signed up for the class, it is at 11 a.m. Eastern on Sunday. And it also, like when you first sign up for the class, you can log in and it has a schedule. Or even when you go to sign up for the class, you click on the link down below. On that page that loads, there's a spot that says schedule. Hit schedule and then you can see all the times that you'll need to know. Okay. All right. Oh, this is a good idea. I've seen other live streams take a fade to black so the ad doesn't just pop up willy-nilly. Oh, that's a good idea. Did you use 80 or 100? This is 80 and this is 80. The only 100 pound cardstock is the red. Okay. Do I ever use Ola markers? I do. I just happened to use Copics today. Okay, let's see. All right, I think I've gotten through all of the questions. All right, thank you so much for joining me tonight. Once again, this was day 10. Day 11 will be up on Wednesday. Hope you'll come back and join me. I love this little card. I think it turned out so cute. It's a nice, fun surprise. All right, I will see you on Wednesday for day 11. Thanks so much for joining me.